So welcome to the American Car Collector Seminar. My name is Jim Pickering. I'm the editor of ACC. And with me I have a distinguished panel of ACC writers and ACC readers and people that I've known for a long time. Today we're going to talk about cars to buy, sell, and hold. Before we get to that, I've got some housekeeping that I need to take care of. First of all, for those of you who don't know what ACC is, we're a magazine that covers the collector car market. We send reporters to auctions all around the world, and they cover the cars that are selling, and they report on the prices those cars bring. Each issue has columns, profiles, market reports, classifieds, all kinds of information. It's a great way to track what's happening in the market at any given time. And you can sign up for a subscription just by going to acc.com, americancarcollector.com. We have a show special right now, so it's a great time to do it. My panel this week, Carl Bomstead, Elana Scherr, Brian Carlson, and Ken Lingenfelter. You guys want to go ahead and tell us a little bit about yourselves? Yeah, go ahead and start.
Good morning. Obviously, I'm a pretty big Corvette guy. I have a very large car collection in Brighton, Michigan. We have 250 cars I've collected over the years. About 30% muscle cars, 30% exotics, and the rest are Corvettes. Performance company is going to be 47 years old this year. We still continue to build General Motors products and enhance Corvettes, and we still do some racing, and very focused and excited to be talking to you this morning and really excited to be here.
Brian?
Okay, Lee Mitchell Carlson. I've been contributing to Keith's publication since approximately 1998. Generally speaking, on an average, I'll be at about 30 to 35 collector car auctions over the course of the year. Everything from like little estate auctions all the way up to here, Monterey Week. And this will also be my second year in a row, I'll be at Techno Classica in Essen, Germany. So I, you know, see a lot of stuff that's going on out there, and I have a very eclectic collection of about 8 to 10 vehicles, ranging from restoring a World War II Ford GPW Jeep to my proverbial company car is a 19 Mustang GT, and a lot of stuff that's varied in between.
I'm Carl Bomstead, and I have been involved with cars since I think I was 16 when I bought a 48 Plymouth convertible. No, a 48 Plymouth sedan. And my dad said, okay, you can buy the car. Of course, it was my money, but you're going to, the title was in his name, and he kept the title on his dresser. And he said, okay, if you ever drive the car off the driveway before you have a driver's license, I'm going to sell the car. I said, well, you can't do that. He said, I sure can. I have the title. So he had me on a very short leash, and I was probably the most well-behaved 14 and 15 year old, and made up for it when I became 16. But I will never have a collection of 200 cars like Ken does, but I can have one car 200 times. So I go through a lot of them. I'm partial to American classics, particularly Packards, but I've had sports cars, hot rods, you name it. I currently have a Intermechanic Italia and a 47 Cadillac convertible and a something else I bought. but I'm into cars. I enjoy them. I've been writing for sports car markets since
97.
Since February of 97.
Every issue of both magazines.
Yeah, every
since 97.
Issue. Yeah. I'm still trying to get paid for two of them.
How do I follow that? I'm Elana Scherr. I've been writing about cars for about 10 years. I started at Hot Rod Magazine, and then I worked for Roadkill with David Freiberger. And I've been freelance for the last couple of years. I've got a column with ACC that I really enjoy doing that's all about daily driving older cars. My husband and I have together about a dozen cars, which is probably not that impressive to these guys, but, you know, it's a lot for us. And none of them are any newer than 93. So I'm living the classic lifestyle.
All right. Now, as I mentioned before, today we're going to be talking about cars to buy, sell, and hold. And one of the biggest things we've seen in the market really over the last two decades is the rise of the muscle car, specifically. And so I wanted to start with a specific look at just muscle cars. And with that, I want to ask the panel, what muscle car would you buy right now and why? And so, Carl, let's start with you. You picked two. 97 Dodge Viper and 2005 Ford GT. What's your thought process here?
Well, the earlier muscle cars are exciting also. I think the biggest concern, or the biggest question with them is that there are so many more now on the road than were ever built. And so if you're buying something like that, you know, make sure that you're spending the time. If you can't do it yourself, pay for somebody to come in and make sure that they are what they claim to be. Because there's nothing worse than finding out 2 days later your buddy comes over and you spent a ton of money for a 446 pack and you find out it's a used to be a straight eight. But the cars that I looked at were a little more performance cars than muscle cars. And maybe it's a generational thing. Who knows? I won't get into that. But I think the Viper right now, the 97 Viper, is, you know, a V10, 450 horsepower, under 50 grand. I think if you want a car that's going to drive you nuts, I mean, I think they're just an incredible value right now.
Yeah, and at ACC, we had one of these cars, and I drove it all over the place. We put 10,000 miles on that car. And I have to say, that thing was so drivable. Ours was the ACR version, which is the harder core version with the harsher suspension, and it didn't matter. The thing drove like a Corvette. It had a soft clutch. It had all kinds of torque. You never had to downshift. I loved that car. I didn't want to sell it.
And if you have a problem, you know, you can get it fixed. I mean, there are parts available, and it's not a... Virtually anybody can work on it, so it's not a big hassle.
And I do think prices are on their way up. This was a poster car for people from my generation, specifically the blue and white striped versions. And, you know, I think a lot of guys are getting into some money now, and they're starting to buy the cars that they had on their walls when they were kids. And so for me, I'm totally with you on this car. Now, what about the Ford GT?
Well, I think the movie, with the very, very entertaining movie, Ford versus Ferrari, entertaining but not particularly accurate, but that's okay. It was a good movie. And I think that is... brought so much attention to the Ford GT, to Shelby, those cars have always been exciting to me, but now I think they're just kind of even more exciting. And there's one sitting out in the Ford display that they wouldn't let me get close to, but oh well.
With the new GT hitting the market, what do you think is going to happen to prices on the older GTs?
I don't think it'll affect them for a while.
Interesting.
In fact, I think over time they'll start to... Well, I think the kind of the bubble will, it'll, because of the excitement over the movie, I think it's kind of, it'll tail off for a bit, but then it'll come back.
Another interesting thought here is the new mid-engine Corvette and what that's going to mean for prices of the GT, if anything.
They have we're kind of going off topic, but they had the convertible out in the lobby, and the guy was raising and lowering that. I got excited about that car.
Yeah, I mean, it changes everything. It's going to be really interesting to see what happens. All right, so Elana, you picked 69 Dodge Charger, and I know that one's close to
nice
my heart.
Nice example.
Too. Yeah, yeah. I know that's actually one of B. Mitchell's photos.
Well, I was going to say, that did bring exceptionally good money.
Which is why I picked it. And then the Buick Riviera Boat Tail. So let's start with a Charger. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I figured I'd go with one that was obvious and one that maybe was a little bit less so. The reason that I picked the Charger is you can still get them. I mean, they made a lot of them for a muscle car, and... Depending on your interest in a muscle car, you know, you can look for an original RT or even a Hemi car or a Charger 500, or if you just want to drive one, the base models look as awesome as the top end ones, and you can certainly do any sort of modifications to them to get them to the level of hot rod that you want them to be. And one thing that I've noticed about the Charger is that it's so recognizable even to people who are not muscle car people, or maybe people who are too young to have remembered Charger even as an older car in their neighborhood. But because of movies and because of shows like Roadkill, where people are kind of using Chargers, it's very, like, it's something that people know when they see it, and it's almost got like a fantasy car feel to a lot of the younger people that I talk to. I mean really fantasy. Like the way that I feel about a Lamborghini Mira, I hear people tell me that a Charger is the car that someday, you know, when they're very wealthy, they're gonna get. So that was sort of why I picked Charger. And then as far as the Buick, I know it's kind of pushing the, you know, definition of muscle car a little bit, but you know, they came with big engines. They're, again, really distinctive. I think that with a lot of the muscle cars, finding one that has a design that is interesting, not just like quirky, like not like gremlin quirky, but like interesting in maybe a sort of European way, is really attractive to people who maybe didn't start with American cars. and are coming to it with ideas of Ferraris or Lamborghinis or, you know, even Mercedes, like these kind of big classic, elegant lines. And I think that both of the muscle cars that I picked kind of reflect that.
Brian, you want to give us the backstory on that Charger? I think it's great.
Oh, yes. Okay. excuse me. In 2018, I covered a Vanderbrink auction in Aberdeen, South Dakota. It was a Mopar Hoarder. We all kind of have our quirks in the collector car world. This guy's quirk, he was afraid of people stealing his cars. So the vast majority of his approximately 250 car collection, he pulled the motors on it and put them in one of his machine sheds. So it's in, which was fine if you know what you're doing and you have a plan B. But when you suddenly die in an accident in your shop and you don't even tell your wife what you want to do with your cars or have no estate planning, all of a sudden these things came on the market. And that particular one is a real deal RT, no engine in it. It was probably somewhere out there in the field. The cars themselves were offered on proxy bid, so you could buy the car, you know, online, but the engines weren't. You had to be boots on the ground on site to go digging through the engine pile to find, you know, okay, where's the 440 that went with that, you know, green RT? Oh, yeah, it's right over there next to the slant six. And that thing brought like 11.5, as you see it right there.
Which I think is really indicative with what's happening with Chargers in general. They are just going up in value like crazy, which is why, personally, I think they're one to buy right now if you can, even one in this condition, because you won't be able to buy them like this for much longer, even for 10 grand.
Real quick, Jim, at that same auction, the high sale was a 69 Roadrunner, 101 configuration, but it was like 101 because it was that same dark green, white bucket seat with the flip center console seat. Guy spent 44 grand on it, flat out told me, they're not getting any cheaper.
All right, Brian, 66 and 67 big block Mopar B-body.
The one thing I keep hearing from younger generations is they're afraid they won't be able to get into the classic American muscle car. They keep looking at the price points going up and going up or even stabilizing, you know, and they look at, you know, their student loans and everything else. It's like, I'm never going to be able to afford anything. These early B-bodies, box cars, you know, as the Mopar Cognoscenti I tend to refer to them, they forever have been the cheapest entry price point for getting into Mopar big blocks. It's easily the cheapest you can get into a Hemi. I've seen two box cars with factory Hemi cars sell for under 50 grand. 50 grand for a Hemi is about as cheap as you'll ever find. I mean, that's pushing buying just a Hemi on an engine stand, you know, with, you know, a moving engine stand to go with it. So once again, looking at, you know, once again, the price, you know, as prices escalate, you know, it being able to cater to the up and coming enthusiasts, if, you know, we get to like 428 Cobra Jets doing 100,000 such, they're going to look at the price, nice, but I can't go there. And they're going to start walking away from our hobby. Low entry price point cars like this, I really feel will continue to do well because, yeah, sure, they won't do 100,000, you know, less. Now, granted, of course, 67s are really the sweet spot year on these because, once again, you get all the, you know, you get the collapsible steering columns and dual master cylinder brakes, and really they are, as far as take it out, drive it, minimal, you know, not having to spend $20,000 to make it streetable in modern conditions, they really are a lot of bang for the buck. And once again, because of that, I feel they'll continue to do well.
All right, Ken, 69 Camaro and Buick GN and GNX.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, the 69 Camaro just seems to have a life of its own. I mean, it's a beautiful design. You see a lot of cars being turned into resto mods or pro touring cars, and it's just got a lot to offer. It's special to me because I frankly got expelled from my high school for drag racing a 302 Boss Mustang right out in front of the school after a dare or so. It'll always be permanently in my mind, but...
Did you win?
I did, actually. I had a 396 375, and this guy had a 302 Boss, and I don't know what he was thinking. because I not only smoked him, I smoked him really bad.
And was he expelled also?
But, you know, he wasn't. I grew up in Dearborn. I went to Dearborn High School. And that's all Ford. So
that's why
I got kicked out and he didn't. I still have a bone to pick with the assistant principal on that one, but they did let me back in after about 6 weeks, but it was not a good, not my finest hour. So, but the 69 Camaro, it just continues to hold its value. There's so much you can do with them. I have to admit these days, you know, I was a teenager, as I was saying, with the muscle car in, but today I like to, I'm spoiled like everybody. You know, cars are so good today. You know, they start right up. When you hit the brake pedal, you know, you can stop with any problem, safety features and everything else. So I think it's a great example, something to rest a mod in. So I think they'll continue to do really, really well, and they're fun. The GNX and the Grand National, you know, there aren't that many GNXs. I think they built something like 540 some. I don't know the exact number. I had one in the collection up until recently. It was a low mileage car, and a collector came through and he made me an offer I couldn't refuse, so I let it go. I'm gonna go back after. I'd like to get a Grand National, but there's plenty of Grand Nationals out there. They're super fast. It shocks you how fast that six cylinder can get down the drag strip. And they're a blast to drive. There's enough of them around, so there's plenty of parts. I just think they're gonna do very, very well, and it's just a great muscle car.
All right. So let's move on to buy, sell, hold. Now, this is an SCM and an ACC tradition, talking about cars to buy, sell, and hold. It's a really a good way to get a sense for what's happening in the market, really through the opinion of people who are in the market all the time. And we've got a great group here that really knows what's going on. So buy cars are cars that we think are going to go up in value. We think they're good investments. Sell cars are cars that we think have either peaked or maybe there's a whole lot of interest right now and it would be a good time to move on that. And then hold cars are cars that are poised to go up in the future, cars that we think are going to continue to be of interest to either the current generation or the next generation of collector. So let's get started with Carl, your buy pick, your first buy pick. I asked everybody to pick two cars. Your first was a 63 Chevrolet Corvette Coupe, which would be a split window. So what made you pick the split?
Well, I think we're kind of in interesting times right now where we have full employment, we have wages at a high level, the economy seems to be doing well, but the collector fields are not doing well. Fine wine is not doing well, fine art is not doing well, fine diamonds are not doing well, as you probably know.
Sadly
and
not.
and portions of the car market are not doing well. So I'm looking at cars to buy that are maybe a little out of the mainstream, a little more unusual, and I think the 63 Corvette split window kind of falls in that category, especially if you're looking at the Z06, where they made less than 200 of them. And it's they're available. They're now selling for, what, 120, 140, but if you want to get into the big tank with the fuel-injected Z06, you're looking at, you know, $650,000, something in that range. But I think if you find a good, just a plain split window right now, I think it's something that's going to get, they're distinctive, and I think over time that they will continue to go up where you may see a general softening in the overall Corvette market.
Would you look specifically for good options, or are you referring to all split windows?
Well, I would look for, of course, I'd buy as many options as I can afford. If I can afford the Z06, and the, you know, I'd
what about like NCRS certification or Bloomington Gold Awards, that sort of thing?
One of the... You brought up something that's kind of funny, because before we had ACC, we were the Corvette collector market, and I was sent to a Bloomington Gold training session to learn more about Corvettes. And you know, after a half an hour, I had a splitting headache as they wondered about which way the bolt was turning and what color was this supposed to be. And so getting there is a pain in the neck, but I think it adds to the overall value and credibility of the car.
So you would look for that over everything else?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, your other pick, now this is pretty specific, 69 Dodge Charger Daytona. Now my first question is, why just the Daytona and why not the Superbird?
Well, the Daytona, I've got the big wing on there and the big nose. Did we pick the wrong one?
No, they both did. The Charger Daytona and the Roadrunner Superbird.
See the big.
But you know, they did. They made fewer Daytonas, which is my assumption is why that's why you wanted to pick those.
Yeah, well, they did like 500 Daytonas in '69, and because of that, they went on to the 70. When was it? Petty said when he went to Ford. And then what Plymouth said, what do I have to do to get you back? And he said, well, build me something like that, pointing at the Dodge. What's interesting on that, they claim that the height of the wing was very scientifically designed through wind tunnel testing and so on and so on and so on. It ends up the height of the wing is such so the trunk will open. That was the only reason why the wing is at that height. But it's interesting.
Larry Rathgeb says that's a myth. He says that's not why it's that height. But it is a good story.
Well, I read a different article. That's all right. But the thing is, like so many cars, like the split window the time that it was offered, being sold, it did not go over well. Some people even had to take out the window. The same thing they couldn't sell the 500 of these that they were produced. So the dealers had to take the nose off and the wing off to even sell the darn things. But now they're kind of coming full circle.
Okay, Elana, your first pick, Corvette ZR1, C4 Corvette ZR1 in specific.
Ken's looking at me. I feel like this generation of Corvette in general has some interest kind of burgeoning in it. I don't know how many of you out there have followed the Radwood shows, but they are all 80s and 90s cars. The audience is younger than a lot of muscle car shows, and these cars, they handle so nicely. They have a lot of the modern things that younger drivers are used to having in a car, but they have a very cool retro look. And then, you know, I picked this, you know, in particular because depending on which year you go, you know, they made better heads. They really had some pretty good performance, especially if you look at the 80s Corvettes, which maybe didn't have quite as much. So I think that's one that you can get very cheap right now. All of my picks, I tried to imagine someone who maybe had a budget cap of about $35,000 because I figured that these guys would be thinking a little more ambitious than that. So, you know, you can pick up one of these. You could probably find one for $15,000 or something that was decent and just start driving it. You don't have to do anything.
And the Dodge Ram Charger.
Oh, okay. So I will have a theme going in a lot of my picks, and that is SUVs. Again, I'm thinking about people who, let's say someone was born in the 90s. They probably didn't even have, their mom probably didn't even have a station wagon, right? Like they've probably been in SUVs their whole lives. Their first car was probably some sort of small SUV. And they're going to like that shape. They're going to have a connection to that shape. And even if they're going back to look at classic cars that are older than they are, they're gonna feel differently about Broncos and Scouts and Ram Chargers than maybe those of us who grew up in wagons or sedans are gonna feel. So I think that we're gonna see a ton of action in SUVs. I mean, we've already seen it with the Bronco. And I think the Ram Charger has kind of been slept on. And there's so many of them. I mean, you can go all the way back to like really sort of muscle car era, and then there's like the rad 70s packages with the wild stripes, and then if you go into the, you know, into the 80s and 90s, you can get fuel injection and some of the other modern comforts. So I think the Ram Charger is the way to go.
They made some Plymouths, didn't they?
Yes, Plymouth Trail Duster from 1974 to 1980.
All right, Brian, attainable pre-war full classics. What do you mean by attainable?
As far as my buy picks, I went with long-term. My first one's a long-term, and my second one's a short-term. Attainable means, when I say full classics, cars that qualify for the Classic Car Club of America full classic certification. And it's one of those people who look at this like, those are big old dumb cars. And the owners are, you know, the owner demographic is dying off by the day. Why are you looking at saying these are a pick? Because wonderful cars are coming up on the market dirt cheap. I watched two, so far this fall, I've seen two 41 Cadillac sedans with Hydromatics, which is in CCCA training. Once again, my choir leader here in the CCCA is going, hallelujah.
I was on the national board for the Classic Car Club for the last 5 years. I finally gave up.
But that is the car du jour for going on CCCA caravans. That's what they want. The 41 to 47, 48 is still, 47 still CCC, full classic certified. And that is the car they want for touring. And I sort of look at it as the gateway drug, as it were. $20,000, you pick up a wonderful, probably original, maybe a repaint, by and large original car. And it'll be one of those cars that's like, you know, this is not quite the fuddy-duddy car I thought. Put a set of radials on it. You'll find out why they're wonderful touring cars. And once again, like Elana had mentioned, the shape kind of is getting more into the crossover, sits kind of tall. So it's not as foreign as a low fastback. So it's one of those, it's not necessary for everybody, and you're not going to triple your money overnight. But once again, like I say, sort of as like the gateway drug, it's the type of vehicle that, and when I do talk to younger folks, there is some interest in pre-war classics. Once again, you know, they look at the Duesenbergs, they look at, you know, Packard Phaetons, and they see seven-digit prices. I'll never be able to get in one of those, and why should I even, you know, consider joining Classic Car Club America? Get a $16,000 41 Cadillac with a hydromatic on it, and they'll probably be hooked.
But then the cars are absolutely bulletproof. That V8 motor was the same engine that was in the patent tanks. They had them in tandem. So, it's, I mean, you can drive the thing forever. It's a bulletproof engine.
Exactly.
Okay, your next pick, very specific again, the 83 to 86 Ford F-150.
Well, I did blanket 80 when this generation started. Ford had some teething problems, more along the lines of they kind of went the wild mood swing the other way as far as, oh my God, we got to shed weight, you know, to meet cafe standards. And they did some really bonehead engine picks. You know, there was like, I believe it was a 4.2 liter V8, which is pretty much, you know, best use I've ever seen for one is a boat anchor. When you get into 83, or as the best way I can describe it is, avoid years that have block letters on the hood. Look for the blue oval. When they went blue oval in 83, they really had these dialed in. My father used to have an 84, so I've got quite a bit of wheel time in them. And you really get the impression, now granted, of course, in the 80s, you got more plastics and stuff like that. But if you're around those trucks, you get a real good idea how this kind of started the steamroller effect, you know, where they're like, to this very day, F-150s are like the global, almost global dominant vehicle for production. So far above even now the Ram being second largest production for any vehicle in North America. But you get an idea, you know, how that started. And they're at a real good attainable price point right now. A lot of there's a little bit of carryover, you know, for folks that, you know, we're thinking about maybe a Bronco. Broncos are moving up and getting fairly high up there in price. But once again, these were the best-selling vehicles in the U.S. You can, it's pretty, if you don't have to settle for a ratty $500 one. Look around, shop around. Once again, estate vehicles pop up very regularly, original miles, original paint. The interior is going to get a little scary, headliner in particular. GM was, you know, in that camp too. But to get the, and once again, you know, these were trucks that were around when I was in high school and in tech school and that sort of thing. So to me, they're not necessarily, they're more of a used car. But once again, to Jim's generation, you know, it's a classic truck. So I see them going nowhere but up and moving up. Once again, the whole world of, look, somebody wants a 67 to 72 Ford or GM, and they keep moving up and they're beyond somebody's price point. Oh, that's a nice 84.
Ken, your first pick, C6 Corvette Z06 and ZR1.
Yeah, obviously I'm a Corvette guy. I'm sorry, I can't help it. But the fact is that you know, there's a lot that has to do with all of our passions for collecting cars and buying cars and such. And I can get real passionate about these cars. That ZR1 is an absolute amazing vehicle. There's so much you can do with it, even to improve the performance as it is. But with the new Corvette coming out, there's downward pressure on the whole Corvette market. It's kind of interesting to watch. If you can't get to a ZR1, a Z06 is also a very amazing car. And, you know, as I said, passion is the thing that drives us. These cars, there's a lot of them out there. There's plenty of parts. There's plenty of opportunity to improve the performance. I don't think you can go too wrong with any of them. Now, obviously, you have to be concerned about somebody who has got a low-mileage car, but it might have been done a quarter mile at a time. And so you got to be careful with regard to what you're buying from that standpoint. But the demographics, they do fit into this. I mean, the fact of the matter is there's a lot of old bald grade guys like me that, you know, are out there and they're doing something different. This is an extremely fun car to own, to drive, and to hold its value. So,
and the IROC Camaro.
You know, again, the demographics come in. The 80s cars are a big deal right now. There's a lot of guys that, you know, saw these cars and wanted them back in the day when they couldn't afford them. Now they're established in their families and their businesses, and they're very affordable. There's a lot of them out there. I happen to think they're drop-dead gorgeous, and I've bought some recently to add to the collection just because people like to come in and take a look at them. There's a lot of variety out there. And I think it's just a really good car to focus on.
Ken, I was really happy when I saw this pick on Jim's list because it was one of the ones I was also thinking of. As the owner of an 81 Trans Am, I'm all about this.
They're a blast. They really are. And I just think they're incredibly good looking. So
there was a really nice one at SEMA this year that had an LS swap with a 6-speed manual. And that changed my opinion of these cars. I already like these cars, but when I saw that one, I thought, oh, okay. Now this makes sense. Now you're getting the performance that was promised to you.
Yeah, they're very hard to supercharge because the engine sits way back in the engine bay. And so, but, you know, there's always heads and cam, right? So.
All right, let's move on to cars that we think should be sold. Carl, your first pick, 66 Shelby CSX 4000 series.
Again, going back to the attention that the movie has brought on the GTs, the four GTs, and the Cobras. The CSX 4000 is actually a reproduction. They call it a continuation, even though it's the 2000 was the first one. The CSX was Carroll Shelby Experimental. That's how the VIN on all of them are. And so the 2000 was the leaf spring, and then later they went to the coil spring with the 3000 coil spring, the 427. But everybody was making a number of copies and so on. So finally in 96, I think, Cobra Shell Carroll's, the company said they make their own reproduction, their own copies, their own continuation. And they licensed to Ford to get a 427 block recast. But for some reason, somehow, you're able to call it a 66 so you can get it through smog. If you ever tried to get that car through Arizona smog, it would be impossible. I mean, literally impossible. That's the toughest place in the world to smog a car. I had a 289, and it took 15 attempts to go through. I mean, it's literally. But I think, again, they are, call them what you will, they are a clone, a copy. And so I think with the attention now would be the time to, you've had your fun with it, a time to move on. But keep the 2000, 3000, they're going to go. They're going to continue to hold their value.
Well, and they are great cars to drive. And I think the key point there is if you haven't had your fun, you shouldn't sell it just because it's time to sell it. You should keep it.
No. But I think that's true of any of the cars we talk about.
Your other pick, which I was sort of surprised to see, 66 to 77 Ford Bronco. Now, these have been on a crazy run. Do you think it's topping out?
That's exactly it. When the checker at the grocery store tells you to buy a Bronco, I think it's time to move on. I mean, that's everything peaks, and I think the Bronco's getting close to that point. And whether you can market time it exactly, but it's if you want to sell, you know, the time to sell is when people are buying, and I think they're buying now.
It's interesting because we talked about these last year too, and I think we called them, I don't know if you picked it as a sell, maybe Jay Harden did, but the point being that we're still looking at them bringing big prices. And so I think we're still sort of teetering there at the top, and it's anybody's guess how long it's going to keep going. It could continue on indefinitely. It's hard to say.
No, it's hard to say, but again, it's we're not saying to sell it because if you love the car, you're having fun with it, what the heck? And you have no reason, you don't need to sell it, don't.
There are certainly a lot of buyers for these now.
Yes, they're buyers now, and then again, the time to sell is when people are buying.
So, Elana, let's talk about finned cars.
Okay, so first of all, I hated doing the sell part because I've sold like 2 cars ever, which is why I have 12 of them. And you told me I couldn't do this panel unless I did some sells. So I tried pretty hard to think about it. And the fin cars, I think, are interesting because there are some that still have just huge appeal across a lot of different markets. I know that Sweden and Japan are pretty into fin cars. But I think that a lot of those are kind of the ones that anyone could name, you know, the Cadillacs and the Christines. And then with the Tri-Fives, the Chevys, those make great drag cars and people still do things with them. So I feel like those are kind of like an exception. But if you are done playing with, say, like a Buick or an Oldsmobile or a Dodge that, you know, or a DeSoto that's finned, maybe let somebody else play with it. I don't know that there's going to be a rising market for those, at least immediately, unless somebody makes a really rad movie about fin cars.
And let's talk about Eldorados.
All right. So this one, I kind of want one, so maybe this is like self-serving. I was with a group of people when I was trying to come up with this list, and we were talking about cars, and somebody said, you know, when I was looking at mid-70s Eldorados 10 years ago, you could pick one up for like $8,000, and you can still pick one up for $8,000, and probably in 10 years you can pick one up for $8,000. So, you know, it's a big car to take up space in your garage if you're not driving it. So again, let someone else take it, and you know, you could put like 2 Opel GTs in the space of one Eldorado.
You would know. All right, B. Mitchell, let's talk about Eleanor and a certain Highland Green Mustang.
Yes. Okay, I guess the best way I can phrase this is Eleanor sold for $2 million, Bullet sold for $3.4 million, yours won't. Sell it, because the market, everybody's abuzz about 67 to 68 fastbacks right now, and sell it before that demographic starts thinning their garage out. The iron's hot right now, and it ain't gonna get any hotter. They're great cars, don't confuse me with that, but it's just, if you've been thinking about moving one out, if you bought yours in 1985 or 1974 for $3,500, sell it now.
And the 1970s nerd cars.
Yes. The thing that came into the big kick, of course, in Wayne's World for that particular Pacer, and generally 70s nerdy kind of cars, it was, you know, once again, a few years back, I would have used the phrase, once again, gateway car. But that was a gateway to a younger, they were appealing to a younger techie generation. They don't like cars. If anything, at best, they're dreaming of a Tesla while they're still making payments on a used Prius. They're more interested in mass transit, ride sharing, Uber, Lyft. That's one of those demographics. You know, I've run out of trying to make them drink Kool-Aid. If it was your grandma's car and it has 35,000 miles on it, you know, you're probably better off just taking it to shows, but thinking, you know, that, oh yeah, I got a Pacer, I should be able to flip that. That's becoming a tougher gig to do.
All right, Ken. Now this one's a little bit touchy here. Yeah. I know you have a lot of these cars.
No, I do. That's right. But, you know, what's interesting is we've seen kind of a dynamic take place even here at Barrett-Jackson with the fact that numbers matching perfect 50s and 60s Corvettes. Again, the demographics got something to do with it. But, you know, they don't run all that well. You smell gas when you're driving them. You know, when you go to hit the brakes, you wonder if you're going to stop. They're just kind of losing some of their appeal. And the ones that aren't are been turned to resto mods. And it's been a phenomenon that's taking place. And I get that, and I understand it. I hate to see what's happening with it, but it's just the way it is. Now, that's the exception. I mean, we were talking about 63 split windows. I mean, those cars will always be iconic. They're beautiful. I saw my first one when I was 10 years old, and it's the thing that turned me into a Corvette guy. So there are special Corvettes in that group, but you know, I think there's a downward pressure on them, and so it's time to think about selling them.
You know, I have to say the C2 Corvette is part of what got me really into cars, and it wasn't because of the way it looked; it was because of the way it drove. These cars they handle really well. They're just really sweet driving cars, and to that I think it. If you can get somebody behind the wheel who's never been in one of these things, this could be a really effective gateway drug into the car hobby. But the prices have to come down to the point where they're attainable by people who are just getting into things.
Well, and that's right. And let's keep in mind now, the prices on these things really did rise, you know. And so there was a time when, you know, they were just golden. I was just at another auction last week, and I was pretty impressed by some of the C2 cars and how well they did. But again, the demographic is the thing that's taking place here, and it's putting downward pressure, I think, on the cars themselves.
Okay, and again, another challenging pick here.
Yeah, it is, again, because, you know, that's one thing. There aren't a lot of the 53s, and so those will always stay pretty popular. But in 54s, you know, they built quite a few of them, actually, and so there is downward pressure on those. 55s, again, limited production. So that helped them, but the demographic is the thing that I see happening, and you know they're just not bringing the money that they used to bring, and I think they will continue to go down, not up.
But I had a 54, and I bought it for $25,000, and I sold it for $80,000. So I'm quite happy with my 54.
I think you should, but I don't think you wouldn't be able to do that today.
I agree with you. I couldn't do it today.
Yeah, not today.
So. You'll get on it at 80 and sell it at 25.
I lost it all on something else. So
you know, the thing is, too, they're not comfortable to drive at all. I mean, these cars are not drivers. They're cars that are going to sit and get looked at. I have a picture. I at one point owned John Wayne's 53 Corvette. I have a picture of him sitting in the car, and his whole head is above the windshield. So, I mean, they're not easy to get in and out of. They're not comfortable. And how those guys in Route 66, you know, were able or could be able to drive those cars across the country, I don't get it.
So the one question I have,
stuff.
Maybe they were smaller.
Yeah, they may have been.
What would you say, custom, restomod, whatever you want to call it, versus stock? Would your thoughts be in the same line with something that's been modified? I mean, I know you've built quite a few C2, C3s that have, you know, Lingenfelter power and lots of cool stuff.
Right.
And the restomod market has been on fire for the last, 3 years now?
Exactly.
And I'm sure we're going to see that again this year. Mm-hmm. So do you feel that those are in a different category, I guess is the question?
Yeah, I think they are. The thing is with the early ones, the C1s, I mean, you got to make more room in the interior. You know, we've been building engines for Dave Kindig for a number of years, and Dave has been really successful in giving them a little bit more stretch, getting some more room in the cab, and all of a sudden it's a resto mod that's not only got enough room to drive, but it's cool and it's got all the right stuff. But they're very hard to, I mean, you've really got to go in and do a lot of work to get more room in that interior. So, that's where I think it's all going. I think it's going to go towards resto mods and not original cars.
All right. Now it's time to talk about cars we think are a good hold. And again, Carl, with something pretty specific, 65 C10 pickup. Now, these are close to my heart, as you know.
I know. You're probably saying buy every one you find.
And then
you're going to go screw them up and put hang all this junk on it that you love to do.
I love doing that.
I know you do.
There's so many of them out there. It's easy to do.
But I want it just to be absolutely plain bone stock. And it's I've never had a pickup.
Ever.
I never. And it's always a city boy, but they're always kind of something that appeals to everybody. I mean, who does not like a nice stock pickup truck? And so it's you think they're going to go up? I'm saying, yeah, hang on and let's find out if you're right or not.
Well, I think they've been going up, but I think we're going to see, especially ones from this generation this year, go up even more. So the 67 to 72s, really the GMs took off, what was that, 5-6 years ago, and they've been on a steady climb ever since. And people are starting to look outside that generation to other earlier and later trucks. And I mean, something like this would be a great buy.
I'm going to hang on to it. If I were to buy one, I'd hang on to it, and I'll let you screw it up with all your mods.
You know, so I will.
And yes, you will.
How have you moved couches if you've never had a truck?
That's true.
He doesn't have any couches.
Couches?
He's the guy who borrows our trucks.
People for that. No, I'm kidding.
All right, now, I think this is that same auction where that Charger with no wheels was photographed. Again, with something specific, a 71 Charger Super B. Now, it was hard for me to find a photo of one of these, I have to say, yeah.
Of all the muscle cars, and I think the qualifier on any muscle car is it truly what it was, there's all the stuff on there is what it was born with. Because so many people add so much stuff to it and make it a clone, make it a continuation, make it a whatever. To me, they're just a plain doggone copy, and stay away from them. But I think that is one that with a 446 pack is just something that has mass appeal. And if you can find one, they only made like, what, 500 or something?
Not many of them out there.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think over time, though, they're going to be a good buy, and they'll appreciate over time.
Alana, let's talk about the fuselage body here just for a second, because I know that the earlier ones have really been on a tear for a long time. What do you think is going to happen with these ones?
I think that they will, people will start to look outside, and you know, you could get some of the very cool engine packages, especially in the 71. So, you know, I think that's definitely a possibility. I would also add maybe the same year Roadrunners, the Plymouths, because I think, just personally, I think they're prettier. And I think people are really going to like them if they look at them. I mean, they almost have like a Jaguar thing going on with this super long hood.
Let's talk about Vipers.
Oh God, I love Vipers so much. All right. So we've been talking about people wanting cars that have some modern comforts, but I think that there's also going to be a backlash, especially against sort of very contemporary cars with semi-autonomous driving and, you know, cruise control and lane keep assist and heated and cooled seats, and people are going to say, I want something purer than that. And I think there is almost nothing outside of maybe the original Cobra that is more pure than the first generation Viper in terms of simply being an engine with wheels and a steering wheel and a seat, you know? And I think they're beautiful. They're not making anymore. And again, with my whole budget thing, you can get one of these for like $30,000. I mean, you could get a not great one for less than that, which is just an incredible price to pay for a legendary sports car.
Jeep Wagoneer.
Back to the SUVs. So one thing I didn't talk about when we were talking about SUVs and why I think they have appeal is off-roading. And I think that in terms of what people are doing with their hobby cars, with their fun cars, with less or fewer and fewer racetracks available to people, I think people are really looking at off-road as an activity where you can kind of get on the throttle, you know, do some donuts. It's not super high speed. And people are interested in that history. You know, people like the Raptor, the new Broncos coming out. There's all these off-road packages for new trucks. So not only does the Wagoneer have the SUV thing happening, but you could off-road one. You know, you could change suspension. You could put big wheels on it, and it would look really rad. So I think these sort of things, Jeeps in general, are, you know, if you've got a good one, hold on to it for a little while, have some fun with it, but I think you're not going to have any problem finding someone else to adopt it when you're done.
So Brian, let's get back to the trucks again. What is it about the dogleg cab that you're interested in?
Well, I see these trucks, and I think back, actually more like, actually even 15, 20 years ago, when you look at the Task Force era Chevys, the 55 and a halves to 1959s. Everybody, 55 through 57 Chevy, they were almost as hot as a Tri-5-4, you know, F-100, 53 to 55. Nobody, it was sort of like, you know, the consolation prize if, okay, yeah, I got a good deal on a 58 Chevy. You know, it had the four headlights, didn't look quite as good. It took a while for them to pick up and catch on and move up in the market. And they are now pretty much moving up in the market. I see the same thing with the dogleg cab Chevys of this era. Collectors have discovered the 64 to 66s, and they are moving up. Once again, if you get a deal on a 65, get one, you know, jack the price up, try to sell it to Carl.
But everybody else does.
Yeah, well, yeah, sure. But the 60s to 63s, once again, I'm seeing the same thing as what was happening with 58 and 60 Chevs. They did pick up, but it, bad pun intended, but it did eventually get to the point where, I mean, especially a lot of the NAPCO conversions on 58s to 60s, they've been bringing big, big money. Granted, of course, you won't have the NAPCOs on a 60 to 63. That was all brought in-house by GM. But actually, on the other hand, there's more factory four-wheel drive Ks. They then became K10s, take K20s, K30s. But it's going to be one of those things when the 64s to 66s start moving up in price and 61s to 63s are going to be, oh, okay, that's ostensibly it's, you know, it's got the same stove bolt or small block in it as, you know, a 64. Yeah, sure, I'll fly there. And it's also probably as time goes by, you know, the flying buttress, dogleg cab will probably start to catch on a little bit more too. So it's just a matter of kind of waiting for that to progress through.
Now, if you're buying, would you look for a long bed, a short bed, a fleet side, a step side? What do you think would be the sweet spot?
Well, pretty much the, you know, the no-brainer knee-jerk action is, you know, short box style side. There weren't that many of them out there, and of course that's, you know, once again, when you get in the world of, you know, tweaking, modifying, you know, everybody wants a short box, but once again, you know better ride with a long box. Step sides, the look with the step side doesn't really, once again, your opinion may vary, doesn't seem to flow as well with this generation of GM pickup. And there's, you know, unlike what, even with the 67 to 72, where it seems to work a little bit better with the restyled fenders, those tend to go a little bit better. So really, short box style side, you know, if you're just looking at buy low, sell high, that would be the great way, the best way to go. But once again, you know, if Grandpa had a long box step side, I would just hang on to it. You know, charged Carl $100 to move his couch when he needs to, and you know, when he finally breaks down and wants to buy it, you know, there you go.
Your other hold is a Modern Muscle.
Oh yes, we are. You know, and you know, obviously not the first one to say this. You know, we are in another renaissance for Modern Muscle, for crying out loud. I never thought I would never, having lived in Germany for 3 years in the 1980s, having lusted after an E30 M3 in 1988 when they were brand new, considering one as a spending my reenlistment bonus in the Air Force on one, I would have never guessed. I wouldn't even consider a BMW and went straight to the Ford store and special ordered a Mustang GT. 460 horsepower, fantastic handling, road trip that thing all day. Dirty little secret on those cars, real quick, by the way. Get the active mode exhaust. You'll love it. Great noise when you want it. Put it in quiet mode on the road. You get 28 to 30 miles per gallon. You couldn't ask for anything better for a road trip car. Absolutely love it. It's everything I would have wanted back in the 80s when I was lusting after 69, 70 Mustangs. But Everything works. Don't have to keep putting it back together. Has a warranty. And going forward into our, kind of beginning goose-stepped into the electric is good, just keep saying it and you'll believe it world that we're kind of getting forced into, these cars are going to be considered like the last bastions of God bless American power. So they will hold their, even the ones that tend to get used a bit, well, they'll go through the mod shops and they'll get other lives. They'll get cast iron coyote blocks to keep going up and down the drag strips. They'll, in 25, 35, 40 years, they'll be out here and, you could have a chance to buy the 2019 Mustang GT originally owned by B. Mitchell Carlson, I'll let it go at no reserve at that point, but that'll be at my estate. So once again, whether it's a Hellcat or the Shelby, especially wide-body Hellcats, Shelby GT350, another fantastic car, just for the driving experience. Camaro ZR1, have to appease Bowtie Jim. You can't go wrong with them. Whether as for the driving experience, and once again, these cars do bring a driving experience to them. They're all cars that you can get with a third pedal, so worst case scenario, Millennium anti-theft device. But in the long term, great cars to enjoy, and they'll continue to do well in the future.
Ken, Cadillac CTS-V.
Yeah, I'll tell you, these are amazing cars. And, they started to build them in early 2000s. I think 2004 was the first Cadillac CTS-V. I can't even begin to tell you how many we've run through the shop because they've been very easy to modify and get more power from. And interestingly enough, the really hot vehicle is the wagon. That CTS-V wagon that they built for 70 years, those prices just keep going up. And if you're familiar with the site, bring a trailer. If you're not, go to it because it's you'll really get a feel quickly on what's going on with car prices and such. And these are amazing cars. Like you said, they come out with a warranty. They're muscle cars. They're very fast. Prices continue to hold or go higher. And I just think they're about the best thing going out there.
That's another one you can get with a stick.
That's exactly right. Yeah. Yep.
When I was out at your collection, you had I think it was an 06 that you guys had put heads and cam on, and that thing was a monster. It sounded amazing.
Yeah. I actually think, there's a real good value in those early CTS-Vs because there's some out there, and again, they're comfortable, and again, if you just want to take it on a road trip, they're fine with that too. So, great value.
And sticking with GM super sedans.
Yeah, I struggled with this one a little bit, Jim, because I don't know if you call this an American car or not. I guess you do.
It's Australian at its core, but it doesn't get much more American than what it is, right?
There you go. So thank you for saying that. I didn't want to send the wrong thing in. Holdens, were built down in Australia, as Jim was saying, and they had LS2s and LS3s in them, the old GTOs, the early GTOs, and of course, they've stopped making them now. They don't do any auto production in Australia at all anymore. So I grabbed one of the last SSs here before they were done brand new, and I tend to do more with it. Customer cars come first, but I put headers and exhaust in it, and I, as immature as it may sound, I'm a noise guy, and I want to hear it when I put my foot in it, and I want to hear it when I'm downshifting, and this car really satisfies you at that point. So they're great cars, and if you watch the Pontiac G8s, they're holding their value real well, and if you want a good one, you're going to pay a little more for it.
Yeah, my neighbor has a G8 GT, and he taunts me with this thing every day. Fires it up, and it just makes my house shake. I love it. It makes me want to go buy one.
It's a little hot rod that's a grocery getter. I mean, I can't get over it. I'd sing the praises of this car on and on and on. So,
all right. So now it's time for some questions.
I'd just like to make a point that has been passed over. just a little bit ago when we talked about the Buick Riviera, for example, as opposed to the Dodge Charger. I think what has happened in the collector car market over the past half dozen years is the change in attitude towards the collector car market in general. And it seems as though it's become that the new collector genre of enthusiasts want to have something that everybody else has as opposed to something that's rare. And when you compare the Buick Riviera, for example, with the Dodge Charger in that same era, I think if you parked a Buick Riviera next to a split window C3 or C2 Corvette, it would look like little brother and big brother. I don't think people have fully recognized that yet. The other point I wanted to make is when it comes to restoration of cars, there's a lot between buy and sell. There's the doing. And I dare say that if in regard to those two cars as a comparison, you would find yourself doing less work on a Riviera to bring it up to standards than you would a 65 or 66 Dodge, which were beaters even back then. And so I just wanted to point that opposing point of view out there, because that's important to the collectors. They're the ones that are going to be working on these cars. And I think that the Buick Riviera in that instance was and is probably better cared for during its ownership than the Dodge Chargers, for example, in that same era. Thank you very much. Great information for you folks.
More questions?
Got a few.
Hi, everybody. Tom Stoller, managing editor of ClassicCars.com.
Hi.
Elena and I are Motor Press Guild members together. How are you? I have to disagree with one thing you said. And by the way, I thought the panel was fantastic. Racetracks are more accessible now than ever. There are so many guys going to Ken's to build track weapons. And there's the country club tracks. What I've been telling most people is invest in your local country club track, because at some point that might be the only place you'll be able to drive a car.
I do agree that the country club tracks are fantastic. They aren't particularly cheap, so I wouldn't consider them accessible to younger folks. And I was more thinking drag racing, really, with tracks closing pretty regularly. You know, I think Los Angeles is down to two. I can agree with that.
Yeah, car culture is not going anywhere. More questions? What about hot rods? As in street rods, hot rods? Well, it's the market seems soft for hot rods. What do you guys think?
I think it all depends. I think if you look at Saturday night here and the hot rods are going to be going crazy. I mean, it all depends where you are and what the market is. I mean, what market you're selling to.
Well, and there's also a distinction between a hot rod and a street rod and a resto mod right now, right? But at their heart, they're not really that different. I mean, you're looking at the year of the car being built, but what is being done to them is very similar, really, in my opinion anyway. And that market is just on fire. And like I said before, I think it's going to continue. So, you know, if you're talking about 32 Fords in specific or something like that, I think it's going to be really interesting to watch and see what happens. And for somebody like me who's always wanted one of those and has never actually gone out and bought one, you know, this might be the time to do it.
Well, and I think that for the old school hot rods, I mean, like sort of the true classic hot rods, like 32 Fords, I think there's actually a whole new group of people who are interested in that, doing things like the Race of Gentlemen and the Hot Rod Hill Climb and stuff like that.
I would say too, though, hot rods in many cases are built so much to somebody's individual taste. And the fact is that a lot of money gets put into them. And then with the idea in some cases that they're going to get that money back, and I can promise you it most never happens. You know, if you're going to do it, you've got to really try to curtail your own personal taste if you're thinking you're going to make some money. It should be just a pure passion thing that you're doing, and it's something you're going to do that you're going to want to drive and enjoy. Not a lot of upside to go back out and resell it, I don't believe, anyway.
The upside is in the use.
That's exactly right, yep.
All right, I hear we have a question from social media.
Go ahead. I have a statement and I have a question. I'm a professional collector car appraiser, been that for many years. And just to bring a little insight from my angle of the hobby, when I first got started, almost all of my work was either actual appraisal work on cars that people had. They want to hire me to go out and evaluate a car before they buy it. Estates were about 5 to 10% of my work. Nowadays, estate sales are 85 to 90% of what I do. This gives you an indication of where this hobby is going. One quick statement, when it was mentioned a little bit more about millennials, and we all joke about millennials and everything, but they are going to be the next people. And for I challenge the concept that they're not interested. The reason why they're not interested is we don't bother to introduce them to the hobby. And I mean, I've taught, I've been in National Concord Judge, I've started junior jury programs and National Concord events, and I couldn't be more serious about this. Is if you take the time to take one, put them behind, have them sit in your car, your precious car, they're not gonna hurt it, have them sit in it, explain some stuff to them, they will be interested. But here's a question for you. I've never heard anybody ever talk about this with regards to our hobby and our older muscle cars. I'm a survivor Corvette person. That's what I collect. But I've never heard anybody talk about gas and where gasoline is going with our hobby. When our older cars, the gas continues to go downhill. And to me, that's a big limiting factor on where our hobby is going with regards to our vintage vehicles. And I don't really see it getting any better. And I'm curious of your thoughts on this. I've never heard anybody ever talk about that as far as an impact on the hobby. Thank you.
I would say it's first off on the point of younger generations' attainability. That was specifically why I picked the pre-war Cadillac. It's one of those cars that you explain a few things, you know, how it operates, and it's becoming a very attainable car. On the subject of fuel, I'm finding it's very much a regional issue. Out here on the West Coast, it's going to be a very big issue. Midwest, where I'm from, if anything, I hate to say, you know, there's more of a renaissance towards boutique fuels, but I will dare say that I'm finding more pumps that specialize in race gas or higher octane fuel, but you have to hunt for them. And once again, along that same line, you know, if I have several of my vehicles that could go, you know, I either throw in, you know, a can of 104 with, like, you know, pulling up the 91 pump, or digging deeper in the wallet and actually putting in 120 race gas. And I'll put in the 120 race gas to make sure that next year when I go out there, that pump will still be there. But once again, yes, it is one of those things that is kind of, you know, the 800-pound gorilla in the back of the room that nobody wants to talk about. And once again, looking at, you know, future, you know, the whole autonomous car thing, you know, this whole, you know, being herded into the world of electrics, just even for what we have right now, it will once again probably just be almost more of a regional thing where, I mean, we're almost kind of seeing it to that point, like, for example, you know, with the Montana LLCs, where on the West Coast, it's like, well, I can't register, you know, this 67 Porsche, but, you know, we'll get a Montana LLC for it, where it'll probably end up being a point where things will, you know, specific collector cars will have more of an interest simply because they'll be able to actually use them more in certain parts of the country.
I need to address the millennial question too. I am a millennial. And part of the reason I'm sitting here is because when I was 16 years old, my dad gave me a car that had a big block Chevy in it. And I was unrestricted. It was my everyday car. I drove it everywhere. I took it out at night and did stupid things. I mean, it was, that is a big part in making somebody have, you know, a need to collect and a need to go back and re-experience the things that they did when they were young. If you never had the opportunity to go out and drive a muscle car the way it's supposed to be driven, why would you ever want to drive one now, right? And so for me, you know, my goal is to make sure that my kids have that opportunity to just take my car and go. You know, I trust you. Go. Go have fun. Go do the things that I did, because it's going to make you understand why I'm here and why I'm doing this. And so my advice for anybody that's concerned about millennials or the next generation is let them drive your car. You know, just tell them, take it out, drive it, do stuff with it, have fun with it. And don't worry about what's going to happen to it. It's obviously it's lived this long. It was designed to do silly things, burnouts and donuts and whatever else. And, you know, what could they possibly do that's going to hurt it, you know, aside from running it into something? But we have insurance for that, right? So to me, that's really the core of it.
You know, we are being forced, I think, into this electric thing. And, you know, the cars are just not available, especially the new ones like they were. I was at a car show not that long ago, and I saw a guy with a T-shirt, and he said, and the T-shirt said, "Thank you for buying your Prius. More gas for me." And I wish I could find that T-shirt, because, boy, I'll tell you, I'd frame it and put it up in the car collection. So,
okay, we have a question here from social media. Valuation question. What do you think of a 67 SS Impala convertible, 327, turbo 400, power windows, nice condition, just an idea, value, hold, or sell?
The question to you. We were just talking about Impalas this morning.
We were. You know, the GM B-bodies in particular, they made a lot of them. And that's a good thing for somebody who's looking to buy one, because there's a lot of nice ones out there. The other thing that's nice about GM's full-size cars is that you can put all your friends in it and you still have room for stuff, right? These cars are simple to fix. There's a lot of parts out there for them. And so in terms of a usability, I think they're really a great choice. I think the market is going to come up on these cars. It hasn't quite done it yet. Like I said, there's a lot of them out there. But they have a really distinct style, and they're very usable cars. Now, they look huge. They seem like they're really heavy. In reality, they're not as heavy as you might think. I drag race a 66 Caprice, and it is about the same weight as a 67 or 68 Chevelle, believe it or not. So, I mean, would I buy one right now? Yeah, I absolutely would. And I think that finding one with good options is the way to go. They you can get a lot of good options in these cars. I mean, these were the top of the line for Chevrolet back in the day, especially the Supersports. And so, yeah, I think for me, it's a buy. What do you think, Brian?
Oh, yes, I would definitely agree. Thing is, of course, you know, the market, current market today is more driven by the Chevelle world, but there's enough enthusiasts out there. And you know, once again, kind of a gateway sort of muscle car. You know, of course, some people, you know, revile on the idea of a full size being a, you know, muscle car. And once again, I was going to also mention that they're also lighter than my Mustang because of all the nanny state stuff that has to be in it. I think, you know, your 66 is probably 100 pounds lighter than a 19 GT.
It's hard to imagine, but it's actually true.
Yes.
Now, Carl, I have to point out that the photo behind you, I put there just for you. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, well, I'm a total civilian to a pretty sophisticated audience here. And I'm also wondering, when you get into estates or having an emotional owner, that I've owned a 69 AMX originally for 50 years now. And again, my daughter has very little interest in the vehicle. So it comes down to, how do you handle an emotional seller that, do I hold it and let the estate sell it? Do I sell it now?
I'll talk to you in a little bit right as soon as we're done.
I mean, I would, you know, I would take a line from the lady who helps people clean out their houses and say, you know, is it bringing you joy right now? Because if it is still bringing you joy, whether or not your daughter's interested in it, then you should drive it, you know, while you can drive it, take it places, maybe take her, go do something with her in it and see, you know, you never know when you might form an attachment with something. It could be later. But if you're worried about it, if it would make you feel more comfortable to know that it's already in hands that you chose, then I would consider selling it so that you have more control over who buys it. If you leave it to the estate, or you leave it to family who isn't interested in it, I mean, they might do their best for you on it, but they are never going to care who takes it, really. So that's, it's okay to be emotional about cars. I am. They're like, I feel like they're pets. And I think there's nothing wrong with that.
Well, this kind of goes back to the auction I mentioned previously out in Aberdeen, South Dakota, where he was a hardcore enthusiast, but he just thought of just his interests. He didn't think beyond, well, what happens if something with about me? I mean, he made no estate planning whatsoever. And that's one thing that I've seen at more than a few auctions is, you know, like I would, matter of fact, that this particular one, I actually had a chance to talk with his brother. I said, did he have like any estate planning? Do you have a will? He discussed it with the wife. Like, no, he said it was his damn business, whatever would happen with his cars. So then what happens? You call up an auction house and they go for whatever they go. One thing that I've kind of started saying is if you love your car, you should be ready to sell it. Because we won't be around forever. Another line that we hear so often is that we're just caretakers. So if you are concerned about what will happen to your car or your collection, you really should think about what will happen if I'm gone or I get sent to the home or whatever. Because once again, and don't think I'll just wait till I'm 65. I have very good friends of mine who are no longer with me that are from the collector car world that never thought, you know, at 42 years old, they'd be tipping over. So think about it.
More questions?
Mike Kent with Cascade Radio Group. Quick question for you. First of all, I want to endorse what the gentleman said over here about young people. Take your car magazines or the car shows, give them to all the young people. Don't recycle them. Recycle them with the next generation. Half the cars on this facility and cable TV almost entirely are being resto-modded. You can't turn on TV. They don't restore cars on TV. They resto-mod cars. What about the mid-priced muscle car, say a 62 Impala SS 327 four-speed car? Nice car, not super high value, maybe 30 grand. What's the prospect for those cars when the resto mod market's getting 100 grand for the same car?
That's an interesting question. You know, the making a resto mod is not necessarily a recipe for making money. So if a resto mod is selling for 100 grand, I mean, it's sort of like the hot rod question, right? You've probably put more into it than that to get it to that point. At ACC, we do some how-to articles in every issue, and one of the things that I've been looking at with regard to that is trying to make a car that's original good enough that you can drive it more often. Not necessarily resto-modding the car, but radial tires, right? That's a good option. We just did a piece on putting a bigger alternator in a car so that when you're stopped at a light, you know, and you've got your wipers in, your headlights and everything on, it's not all moving slowly, right? Stuff that you can do to your old car to make it a little bit better so that you'll actually use it, I think is key for the future of a lot of these cars. Now, as in terms of value, I mean, the car that you mentioned, is it going to go up in value? I think it probably will. But it's going to come down to the car's condition and, you know, how many buyers are out there for it at any given time. I mean, I don't know. What do you guys think?
Jim, this is a really interesting topic. I'm glad you brought the question up because I look at value in a lot of different ways. One of the values is your enjoyment of the vehicle itself. I mean, radial tires, obviously. You know, that's a great one. I'm not sure if that 62 Impala is going to increase in value or not. They're very nice cars, extremely good looking, you know, and all of those things. But the majority of the value is the passion that you have for the car and enjoying it. And if you're going to do all those things to it and it's going to sit in the garage and not get used, then I think you're going to take it on the chin, you know, intellectually and also when it goes to sell. If you're going to do it because you like it and you're going to enjoy it and it brings you joy, that's the key. To me, that's the way it should be. So,
I personally am a purist, and I think once you start taking your pickup truck and adding stuff onto it, or taking your Chevy and start adding onto it stuff, I think you're taking away at least to my standpoint, you know, the value of the car. I know I'm standing alone on that, and that's fine.
I think actually you're right on the money about that. You're taking away a certain aspect of value, and you're exchanging it for a different kind of value.
I think at the end of the day, we both get to the same place, that to enjoy the car. I think the mistake you make is not doing anything. Other than that, anything you do, I think, is right. It's just how you look at doing it.
I mean, people have said before, it's only original once, but I think that folks get kind of casual with that, because to me, there is no difference between a car that has been restored to original and a car that has been resto-modded. Neither one of them is original to me. So, and you can undo anything. So if a car is not the original body, the original interior, at least close to original paint and engine, then, but it looks like an original one, but it's all been taken apart down to bare metal and repainted, and it has a reproduction interior and it has a rebuilt engine, even though it looks like a stock car, to me, that is not an original car. And so I don't think there's anything that's more evil about having resto-modded a car, because you could still undo it all. You could take it all apart and do something else with it.
If you're judging a car at a Concours or even at a show and shine, I mean, you may have an original car class, but you don't have a resto-mod class. I mean, so you're kind of off on your own, playing with your own friends and your own group of people.
Well, unfortunately, the example that you gave is really a good one, because there are so many Impalas out there, right? So if you were going to take a car and resto-mod it, that's a great one to do, because there are still a whole lot of original ones out there. And quite frankly, if you're a purist such as Carl here, and you really love an original Impala, seeing a resto-mod is not necessarily a bad thing, because all of a sudden yours is just a little bit more special.
Well, and the other thing about that particular for 58 to 64 Impalas is going to auctions, I pretty much have seen at this point basically they're flatlining, and that's whether we're talking stock, modified, Biscayne with a 6, Impala with a 348. It's one of those cars, while the core, when I was in high school, I always wanted one, is starting to go away. Younger generations of all sorts of different cultures who have always been into those are taking notice, and they're, once again, they may be dipping a little bit in a certain way, but, you know, a younger generation that it becomes a little bit more attainable can now pick them up. They seem to be pretty much flatline value-wise, but interest-wise, they seem to be maintaining. And once again, that's whether we're talking being a rivet Connor like Carl or, you know, going the full resto-mod route.
One other thing I want to note, kind of going along with the notion of the younger generation, our IT guy at ACC and SCM is a JDM guy. He's into Japanese cars. And he's younger than I am. And he is so into this stuff. I mean, just crazy into this stuff. He will drive 1,000 miles to go to a car show. And his friends will drive from other states to meet him there. You know, you don't see that with muscle car guys, because I don't know if it's because there are so many of us or what it is. But I think that we're pretty safe in that the younger generation is extremely dedicated. The ones that are into this stuff are all the way into this stuff. I don't know if you guys have seen that too, but that's something that I think is something we should note. Any other questions?
Yes, I have a 75 or a 76 and a 77 Nova. I used to have a 75. Both luxury Nova hatchbacks. I haven't seen a single one here ever on Barrett-Jackson or really at any car shows. I know a lot of that stuff went to the crusher because it was just a bad error for the gas crunch and we had emission control stuff on. But 74 I see as the cutoff, and I've seen some big numbers on those cars, but I haven't seen any of this. It's like, do I have a bad investment? I mean, I got two of them. I'm thinking, should I get a third one? So I got triplets instead of twins. I mean, they're both identical almost. There's some more history that goes along with the 76 that I think might bump the value up. And I saw something here the other day that had the bumper sticker on it from a dealership. I'll go into that later if you'd like to talk about it. But, you know, I haven't seen any of those cars here. And it's like, do I have something that's a bad investment, or I just have something that hasn't seen the market yet?
You know, Barrett-Jackson has more cars this year than I think they've ever had. And, you know, just because you haven't seen it here doesn't mean that it's not interesting or shouldn't be here. I think you have something that you just don't see a lot of, frankly. I mean, I don't know. What do you think, Brian?
Well, quite frankly, as far as addressing that generation of Nova specifically here,
actually, it's probably more just a commentary about specific consignments. Generally speaking, when somebody consigns a car here at Barrett, they want to do the home run. Now, are you thinking about doing a home run on a 76 Nova? No, that probably isn't going to happen. I mean, unless you have like a 70 mile on the odometer original, you know, that generally most folks aren't thinking about. They're looking at something that they can bang 30,000 to 300,000 out here. So that's probably specifically with your specific era of car here. Now, in the greater market, the thing I see with 70s Novas is, especially if we get into SSs, I kind of have this thing in my mind, assume fake until proven otherwise. There's been so many of those cars that have been so heavily modified over the years that when you get the occasional grandma original low miler, you know, they do kind of stand out a little bit. So once again, at that price point, they're not a bad car to get into, but once again, looking at what you would do with it in the long run.
Any other questions? We got one more? Yeah, go ahead.
In selling the car.
Why don't you go ahead and repeat the question so everybody can hear?
Well, he's asking where's the best place to resell a very specific coach-built Packard. And this used to be the place. You know, back in the way back when days, I mean, this was founded on selling classic cars and Noel Barrett, and that's how this was the place. But it's no longer. They tried it for a little bit, but now you're pretty well limited to, worldwide is selling a number of American classics tonight, but you're pretty well limited to worldwide, RM, Gooding. They don't do particularly well here. I hope nobody's here to hear this because they'll get mad at us, but that's where I would go. Or specifically through the Classic Car Club of America, you know, through advertising it through their magazine.
And I would also infer Mark specific clubs. Actually, this year I was, my opinion was sought on two different full CCCA classics. And in both cases, you know, the owners were sort of going, well, you know, I'm sort of thinking going the auction route here, but you know, you say run it through the club. Both cars sold through club members, basically no advertising whatsoever. They sold internally within the club.
And then on Bring a Trailer, they now have a new high scale division, if you will. It seems to be working. So there's a couple possibilities for you.
All right, I think that is it for our seminar. I want to thank my panel for being here. Check us out online, americancarcollector.com. We have a show special going on right now. We do 6 issues a year. Thanks so much for coming.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you.